warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Today it's my pleasure to be here to present at the forum Kajian Pembangunan, and I'm here to present about the foreign direct investment in Indonesia in Indonesian maritime sector. Okay, what we already hear about the presentation from Professor Wang Yonghai about how China could be involved in the development of maritime sector in Indonesia as one of my part of presentation today. And according to the presentation, I will present some points here. Number one is about the logistics sector performance in Indonesia, and the second one is about the strategic maritime sector, the investment need that we need to finance our ambition to be a global maritime axis in the world. And the fourth one is about how the maritime sector will come FDI. Are we open enough for foreign direct investment or not? The next one is about China as one of FDI source in the world, right? Including Indonesia. How big is China in maritime sector? I will discuss that one. And also, I will discuss about the non-economic factors that could be a kind of barrier for Indonesia to build a maritime sector. Okay. And the last one is communism. About the logistics sector that we can see here, basically we are having so many shipyards right now, very, very the size. But again, we are operating very big shipyards right now with a weak performance in Indonesia. And the impact of the weak performance of logistic and maritime sector in Indonesia, we can see here the share of logistic in Indonesia is very high compared to other countries. Indonesia was around 27% of GDP, the logistic cost to our GDP. Compared to other countries here, such as in Singapore, it's only 8%, Malaysia is 13%, Thailand is 15%. What does it mean by the best performance of our logistics sector here? Okay. The high cost portion of logistics sector to the GDP means that we are very inefficient in serving our economy. As one example of why we have a very bad performance in the logistics sector, we can see that how Tanjung Priok as our main or biggest seaport in Indonesia, the current time right now is between 5 to 6 days for during time. Okay? And we can see that basically the current time in Indonesia at Tanjung Priok port here is twice as long as current time in Malaysia, and five times longer than Singapore. This is very very inefficient. If you want to compete and if you want to use our logistics or even maritime sector in Indonesia. We see the bad performance of our maritime sector or even logistics sector, and basically the strategic maritime sector is very important for us. We are a country with a scattered island. We need a transportation, we need sea transportation. So far we just only use sea transportation for only less than 9%. The biggest portion, I think, is more than 85% is by using road, meaning when you are transporting goods and services from one location to other location in Indonesia, we are very much dependent to road, truck, bus, etc. That's very ironic to the Indonesian economy. And here, why the maritime sector is very strategic to the Indonesian economy? We are targeting to have a kind of the share of logistics spending to be only 23% of GDP in 2015. when we are trying to get the 23% of GDP for the logistics cost, basically we can have more efficient our economic activity. And if we are able to reach the logistics cost to be 60% of our GDP, meaning right now is similar to Thailand, we can save around 70 billion to 80 billion a year. It's a big number, 70 to 80 billion. Basically, the ambitious maritime project of President Joe Biden now, it just need around $66 billion within 5 years. So once we achieve a good performance of our maritime sector, that to present a lot of the cost to GDP is around 16%, meaning the total budget that we invested to build maritime sector is equal to 1 year benefit from having a good performance in maritime sector. It's very big benefit from maritime sector. Okay, in detail, how many benefits that we can get from maritime sector? We can see by having 60% of our logistics to GDP, we can get around 32 billion from fisheries sector, 56 billion from coastal business, 2 billion from marine tourism, etc. So by investing around $60 billion within 5 years, as the party of the president, we can get it easily if we have a good performance in maritime sector. Okay, I will give illustration here how the ambition of Pak Jokowi to build our maritime sector here. Basically, we need around 700 trillion, or in US dollar, we need around 55.4 billion. But how can we finance the dream to build our maritime sector here? In 2015, basically, there is a pledge or kind of commitment from the government to finance the maritime sector around 8.4 billion from government, and from private national private companies is around 2.4. How about the rest? We still need more money to finance our maritime sector. We still need around 10.6 billion in 2015. So from which country that the API is coming from? This is the main part of my presentation. How can we finance another $10 billion in a year? So within a period of a 5 year period, I think every year we need around $10 billion, and we have to get it from overseas, meaning from foreign direct investment. From the picture, we can see that basically in 2015, some countries like Australia, Japan, China, and Korea already commit to invest their money in Indonesia. But again, only in 2015. We don't know yet about the next following years until 2019. Okay. And in detail, Australia commit to invest around 150 million. From Japan is 40 million. China, 5.35 billion. Korea, 4 billion. In this case, you can see that basically the share of the commitments coming from China is more than 50% to build our maritime sector here. But again, is it easy to get this kind of foreign source of FDI? We're still facing kind of problem, barrier to invite foreign direct investment, because sometimes non-economic issues, national security, sovereignty, come up, could be bigger or larger than economic issues or economic concern. Okay. And here are detailed information about the investment by project here, like how can we move 24 seaport development, subsea shipping, the cargo facility and bulk, multi-mode transportation, revitalization of 12 dockyards, container ships, bulk carrying, tug and bulk. Tug is a kind of tuna, common one kapal. Talking about how the commitment of FDI coming from South Korea, China, Japan, and Australia, you can see here the commitment of those countries are trying to build maritime sector, especially for countries like Australia, South Korea, and China are trying to build a seaport or dockyards here, and other countries like Japan are trying to build or invest their money in in fisheries industry. Those two countries are committed to invest their money in Indonesia as part of the dream of Pak Jokowi to build maritime sector at least within 5 years, from 2015 to 2019. Okay. We discussed about the availability of money coming from government and also the availability of money coming from foreign sources from FDI. At that picture, basically, we can see that the dream of Pak Jokowi is real, is logic in terms of money. Because at least in 2015, all money that we need already available. At least these countries are committed to support the investment or to build maritime sector in Indonesia. Okay, but how does the maritime sector work on FDI? Are we open enough for this kind of FDI? Okay, we can see here the openness can be seen through the level of restriction applied to the certain sector of industry, and we can see basically the openness of how can we welcoming FDI. There are some benefits of welcoming FDI, including employment creation, transfer of technology, capital accumulation, increased competition, because we think that competition is better other than imperfect competition. Economically, yes, we need to open FDI to come to Indonesia. But there are some negative impact of welcoming FDI. Maybe you already familiar with, including the dispersion of local uncompetitive firm will be done, and also uneducated, unskilled laborers, and also the possibility of monopolistic business operation. Because they already invest their money in some strategic maritime projects, they may control their money. So the possibility of monopolistic business operation is there, it's possible. So that's why some group of people in Indonesia are trying to protest against the welcoming FDI into maritime sector. These are a picture of how we should open our maritime sector. From the table, we can see that basically average restriction by sector and subsector of all countries in the world right now is for international maritime is around 0.28 and domestic maritime 0.33. How can we see the number? Basically, we see the number of 1, meaning the maritime sector is closed for foreign direct investment. And if we can see 0, meaning that we are all open, free to FDI. And we come into detail about the international maritime sector and domestic maritime sector between the countries here. You can see that basically Indonesia is around 0.35 for both international and domestic maritime. Other countries like Philippines and also Malaysia basically is less open compared to Indonesia. And what kind of restriction that other countries may impose for FDI? Here, for Indonesia basically, we welcome foreign FDI to come to maritime sector is around 49% to invest their money in Indonesia. Meaning if we set up a company, let's say a company to build maritime sector, so the maximum share of foreign ownership is only 49%. But again, there is exception. especially under the PPP partnership, public-private partnership. Basically, the ownership of foreign people could be higher, more than 95%, but during the concession period. The transport sector especially is more open in Indonesia compared to other countries like Indonesia. China is less open if you see the maritime sector. Okay. As was discussed by Professor Wang Yonghe, basically, how big is China? China could be seen as the main of foreign FDI into Indonesia. As I already explained, basically China already commit to invest their money around more than 50% to build maritime sector. Maybe this condition is related to the ambition of China to build 21st maritime sector, and Indonesia is the ambition to build global maritime crisis. So both could be complement each other and could be a kind of good cooperation or win-win cooperation between China and Indonesia. And how basically China see the possibility to invest their money in Indonesia. Here, I use data of 2013. Basically, Indonesia is the second largest market for China's overseas foreign direct investment here. In 2013, China commit to invest their money around 2.5 billion. But here, in 2015, China already commit to invest their money around 5.8 billion US dollar. Meaning, the invested money coming from China in 2015 is much larger than what's happening in 2015. Even in the overall economic activity. Okay, as explained by previous presenter, Professor Wang, basically China is a huge market, it's a huge country. As we know, basically China is could be the second or the first largest GDP in the world right now. And we can see China also very, very ambitious to build their maritime sector. And China right now stands on the top of the list in terms of the competitive companies in building maritime sector. But again, China still faces some problems, including the low complexity vessel and deeply dependent on the bulk carrier market. And the share of the high value added production capacity is still less than 10%. Meaning that the service of China's maritime company is more on low level value added production. Okay. We already discussed about the possibility of how can we build our maritime sector in Indonesia. In terms of budget, at least in 2015, we are on the track. So we are start to build our maritime by using our national budget. It is around 125 trillion, and another 10 billion come from China, South Korea, Australia, and Japan. Okay, but from other factors, especially for non-economic factors, should we go or not to go? Economically, yes, the investment fund could flow the sector that are active now and with relatively high returns. I mean in maritime sector. But we still facing the humongous lack of budget because we don't know yet about the foreign direct investment, especially from 2016 to 2019. We don't know yet about the foreign commitment to finance our maritime sector. Okay. As we know that basically seaport is very vital to Indonesia. And we need foreign FDI to find the gap, the humongous gap inside our ambition. And also, there are some negative comments or a contraposition on why we should develop our maritime sector, especially coming from Indonesia Maritime Institute. They say, no, it's not fair enough to build our maritime sector financed by foreign direct investment. And there is kind of foreign FDI sentiment inside our country, coming from either parliament members or coming from NGO or even coming from the public in general. Here, as I quote from the Indonesian Maritime Institute, all seafarers should be controlled and managed by the government, meaning there is no need to welcome foreign FDI. Another voice, the contra voice coming from Kadin. The implementation of sea highway and maritime access should be based on national strength and give the priority to domestic industry other than foreign government. The next kind of negative voice to welcome FDI. Okay, I will give a very good example. Should we welcome FDI or not? And we can look at back to the case of Japan. Japan was devastated after World War II. And how Japan can build, rebuild their nation. In 1950 to 1960, basically Japan was financed by the World Bank. At the time, Japan borrowed money from the World Bank around 850 million US dollars in 1950. What's the money for? I mean, how can Japan use that money? The Japan are trying to build the energy sector, infrastructure, including subway, etc. And within 20 years, Japan become the donor of World Bank. And from the devastated countries, after World War II, Japan become developed countries. So again, this kind of picture basically could inspire us whether we should welcome FDI or not. Of course, any decision that we take, any decision that Pak Jokowi take, could give many implications, including positive or negative. And I already discussed about the negative impact of FDI, including the possibility of monopolistic business coming from FDI. But on the other case, we can see a very big benefit coming from a better developed maritime sector, which is in a year we can save money more than 70 billion, which is equal to 5 year money invested into maritime sector. Okay. Come to the final slide here, covering notes. I would like to mention that we should think openly. We should think logically, how can we welcome FDI besides the negative or positive impact. With facing the difficulties of the lack of the national budget, we should welcome FDI as must. Okay, I mean the contra point to welcome FDI as a strategic and sensitive maritime sector. Okay, it is the government task to minimize the potential negative impact of FDI, including how the government could socialize, how important is our maritime sector, how important is our better developed maritime sector. So it is the task of the government to socialize, to disseminate any positive impact of FDI to the public. Okay? And the government should convince the opposite or the contra voice, including how or what's happening when the local uncompetitive and unvalid people displace from the competition. That should a kind of help coming from government to those kind of uncompetitive industries and people. And the next one is there should be a kind of some preference of maritime projects that are available for domestic companies only. Of course, after we discuss about how open is our maritime sector to foreign direct investment, which is coming from around 49% to 95% condition. We should close API into a kind of subsea shipping, atomistic shipping, should be close to API. This is, I think, according to the law number 17-2008 for the sequence here, cabotage principle, that all domestic shipping, subshipping, subsea shipping should be served by domestic or national firm, national flagship, not by foreign flagship. That's the point. Okay, as the maritime sector is very sensitive sector and closely related to national security, the government should pay attention in controlling the possibility of monopolistic business operation coming from the BI. So again, by limiting the number of ownership from around 49%, and also some projects, especially for subsea shipping and domestic shipping, should be closed for ABI, I think could be a win-win solution. In the case of we need their money coming from ABI, and we need to develop our maritime sector, but again, we should control the use and also the possibility of monopolistic business operation coming from ABI. That's all of my presentation, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sundari. I think